In this footage, we can see Ukrainian troops crossing a river at significant speed, presumably in a speedboat or some kind of landing craft. Oh, they're on land, and still moving at significant speed. This is because these troops are in fact on board a PTS. PTS, which stands for Medium Amphibious Transport Vehicle, is a remarkably interesting design first produced in 1965. Many modern militaries, including both Russia and Ukraine, still use this 20-ton behemoth. Upgraded many times through the years, the PTS has remained in service for decades. But what's it for? And how did the Soviet Union go from this to this? As always, we'll quickly rewind to the Second World War, when the Soviets received almost 600 American-made DUKW amphibians through the Lend-Lease Act. The DUKW, or DUK, was a versatile and successful vehicle, and saw service in Italy, Normandy, Belgium, Holland, and Germany, as well as in the Pacific. Liking the vehicle but not having had the experience to create a superior amphibian of their own, the Soviets made a copy, the Zis 485, which was based on the Zis 151 truck. This was built to complement the GAZ 46, the Soviet equivalent of the Ford GPA. Around 2,000 Zis 485s were built, and it became a key component of any Warsaw Pact country's amphibious operations. But these vehicles were, at their core, 6x6 trucks, and couldn't carry all that much cargo, just under 2.5 tons. So, come 1947, the Soviets had a problem. The equipment that a standard rifle division would need, including jeeps, trucks, anti-tank weapons, and heavy artillery pieces, just had no way of crossing during amphibious operation, leaving the riflemen vulnerable on the other side. This led to the development of a completely new and completely Soviet design. The project was given to an engineer named Anatoly Kravtsev, who had extensive experience of amphibious vehicles, thanks to his previous work on the T-37A and his various experiments trying to float a BT-5. Kravtsev set to work, adapting the M2 artillery tractor to meet the requirement. However, the dimensions of a 6x6 truck or a heavy artillery system meant the new vehicle had to have a cargo platform at least 7 meters long and more than 3 meters wide. After a number of failed designs, Kravtsev and his research group achieved this on the 7th attempt, and the K-61 was born. K-61 featured a lengthened hull controlled by a cab at the front with a large sloped bow. Below the cargo compartment was a Yaz 204 engine, a license-built version of the American Detroit 71. And at the rear of the vehicle there were ramps to allow equipment to be unloaded and loaded with ease. Below these ramps were the large propellers, which would enable the K-61 to operate at speed, using both the tracks and the propellers to motor across any foreseeable obstacle with its precious cargo balanced on top. For especially large or heavy loads, multiple K-61 vehicles were tethered together to create a much larger floating platform. You can see here four K-61s being used to transport an ATT tractor and its heavy artillery piece. For tanks, the K-71 was used instead, which was a K-61 with two huge folding pontoons, which the tank would then drive on top of for transport. Kravtsev was awarded the equivalent of the State Prize of the USSR in 1958 for his work on K-61, which went into production the same year. The next step, of course, was to make it bigger and faster. The K-61 could carry 3 tons on land and 5 tons in water. Its replacement, the PTS, would more than double that. PTS, based on the ATS-59 artillery tractor, was scaled up considerably from K-61. It can transport 5 tons on land and 10 tons in water, and has a much more powerful A712P V12 engine. The vehicle can transport a 5-ton truck, 70 troops, or 12 stretchers. In addition to this, and my favourite thing about the PTS, is it can also tow this little amphibious trailer called the PKP. The PKP had fold-out pontoons of its own, and meant that the PTS could carry a heavy artillery piece, its crew, and the ammunition in a single trip. Soon after its adoption in 1965, the PTS was upgraded to PTS-M standard, featuring a more powerful V12 engine. The names PTS and PTS-M are often used interchangeably, which I found incredibly annoying. The next version of the vehicle, entering service in 1973, would see more significant changes, the PTS-2. This vehicle might look remarkably similar to the PTS and PTS-M, but is instead based on the MTT heavy cargo carrier, which used the same suspension system as the T-64 main battle tank. The engine was twice as powerful as the PTS-M, providing 710 brake horsepower. These upgrades allowed the PTS-2 to carry 12 tons of cargo, on land and in water. Further improvements would be made to the design, resulting in, shockingly, the PTS-3, Though, due to the collapse of the Soviet Union in the 1990s, the PTS-3 quickly ran out of funding and the project was cancelled with no orders placed. No more upgrades would be made until the PTS-4 entered service in 2013. PTS-4 would this time use the T-80 suspension and running gear and the engine from the T-90. PTS-4 would weigh almost 33 tons and is able to transport up to 18 tons of cargo on water. These new vehicles would be fitted with a 12.7mm remote weapons station, while keeping the armoured cab of its predecessors. The increased capacity of the PTS-4 allows it to carry BMP infantry fighting vehicles, which previous designs could not. It's important to note here that while the BMP is itself amphibious, and this might seem a little bit redundant, the BMP is much slower and much less capable of handling currents and waves, so this is still an important upgrade, allowing rapid deployment of a very good vehicle. Many former Warsaw Pact nations still operate the PTS in some capacity. These are most commonly PTS-2 vehicles, but many PTS and PTS-Ms are still in operation around the globe. Egypt used the PTS-M transporters in its successful amphibious operation over the Suez Canal during the Yom Kippur War, and like I said earlier, it is still in operation on both sides of the conflict in Ukraine, with Russia and Ukraine both deploying their PTS-2 vehicles in various bridging and amphibious attempts. The footage in the background shows a Ukrainian PTS-2 transporting an ambulance across a relatively wide river earlier in the war. In this image, we can see a destroyed Russian PTS-2 in Luhansk during a disastrous attempt to cross the Seversky-Donets River. The PTS is an incredibly capable vehicle, but it's apparently not immune to Ukrainian artillerymen. It also doesn't help that the Russians keep abandoning their equipment, with Ukrainian troops capturing this fully intact PTS-2 that had been left behind during a retreat. The Ukrainian forces reportedly only had about 15 PTS vehicles at the start of the conflict, but knowing the Russians, this number had probably increased considerably. The PTS, while being interesting and a bit more relevant, did have a Western rival, the Lark series. The Lark V is smaller than the PTS, carrying around 5 tons of cargo. The Lark XV is probably comparable with a 15 ton capacity. But the Lark LX, however, is massive, with a gigantic 100 ton cargo capacity and being able to comfortably carry even the PTS or main battle tanks. This comparison is a bit unfair, as the Larks were built to be deployed from amphibious assault ships during a landing and were not meant for frontline use. Also, PTS uses tracks, which are way cooler. I hope you found this little video interesting. If you enjoyed, please drop a like, and if you want to see some more content from me, why not subscribe down below. I'll see you in the next one.